Okay, welcome everybody to this week's FLAN seminar. This week we have Frank Drews from Umeå University who will be presenting on graph extension grammars, extension graph grammars. So I will turn it over to you.
Thank you very much. I will first of all start sharing my screen. Let's see whether it works. So you should be seeing it now. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So actually you were right when you first said it, graph extension grammars, not extension graph grammars. But it doesn't really matter. It's a kind of graph grammar, but we call the mechanism it's based upon graph extensions, and therefore we coined this term graph extension grammars because graph extension graph grammars seems a little bit yeah. So this has actually worked together with this particular thing that I'm going to talk about is a joint work with Johanna Björklund and Anna Jonsson. Then there is actually one more person involved in the research, a former master's student of mine who has written his master's thesis on this subject. And we are going to do something based on his master thesis as well. Once we know about the fate of the paper, from which I will pick a few things in order to tell you here. As I mentioned, before I continue, please, anybody, if you so we have plenty of time. I won't go into any. Well, it depends on how you view technical details, but from my point of view, I've tried to not go into any technical details. But if you'd like to know something more, or you have a question or something's unclear, then please really feel free to interrupt or to write in the chat at any time. So I can explain or answer questions or whatever. And of course, you may also ask questions afterwards. So that said, these graph extension grammars are, as I already mentioned, graph grammars. So they are grammars whose generated languages consist of graphs and not as usual strings or, well, as I guess all of you are aware of, there are also tree grammars. I mean, graphs are basically the next level of generalization. And they have been studied for quite a while, but not these particular graph extension grammars. These graph extension grammars are an extension, a generalization of hyper-edge replacement grammars, which some of you may be familiar with. Since I don't expect everyone to be familiar with those hyper-edge replacement grammars, I will tell you what they are in an hopefully technical manner, and then talk about in which way graph extension grammars generalize those. And if we use them in natural language processing, I mean those grammars, those graph extension grammars are just a notion of graph grammars, and that could in principle be used in any context where you want to specify graph languages. So you want to typically distinguish between well-formed graphs in the context in which graphs arise, and not so well formed graphs, which is the usual way in which you use grammars. And that could be done in any area where those grammars are useful. But if you use them in, for example, natural language processing, as I would like to show you, they can, in particular, generate structures that that are graphs representing the semantics in the sense of abstract meaning representation and so on of sentences, which then contain parts that arise from or structures that arise from, for example, the coreferenced resolution, which is something that high-pitch placement grammars really have difficulties with, and I will try to explain to you why that is a thing that that they are not so well suited for. So the one thing here is that I'm even though I'm not going to talk about technical results, there is currently a paper under review which introduces those graph extension grammars. But this paper technically focuses on restrictions of those grammars or introduces specific properties that make it possible to come up with an efficient membership test. Given a graph, check whether this graph is indeed generated by the grammar. And I should be a little bit careful here. Efficient means polynomial, and that's always something that you may well, not always, but especially in an NLP context, it's a bit of an oversimplification. Also because the polynomials that arise here maybe of rather high degree, unless you have additional assumptions, so place additional requirements on the things and so on. But here, I will not talk about this efficient membership test. And I mean, unless someone wants to know something about it, then I can of course do that. Please ask me in that case, but I will not focus on this efficient membership, but instead focus on the grammars themselves and what they can do, what they can't do, what I would like to do in the future, and so on. And for these reasons, or for this reason, I will also not talk about the restrictions that we need in order to make the membership test efficient. So let me first talk a little bit about hyperedge replacement so that you know what we are starting from. Hyperedge replacement grammars, well, as mentioned, they are graph generating grammars with rules that, they are context-free. That is something that I maybe should have mentioned here. They are context-free, and that in context-free Chomsky grammars, you know, that means that the rules replace individual symbols in a string. So they do not interfere with each other and so on. So you can apply a rule in any place and do it in any order and whatsoever. The idea behind hyperedge replacement graph grammars is the same, except that the atomic items, like the symbols in a string that are being replaced, are hyperedges. And we use hyperedges here and not just edges, in order to increase the power of these grammars. And a hyperedge, if you don't know it, is just the same thing as an edge, but it may be connected to any arbitrary number of nodes. You may have a hyper edge connecting three nodes or four or even zero. So in my examples here, I actually only have hyper edges that if you look at this one here, that are attached to only one node, and hyper edges that are attached to two nodes. So this is actually a very simple case, but just imagine that, well, I've done this for simplicity only. So just imagine that there could also be hyper edges here which are connected to or attached to, let's say, three, four, five nodes. And even though in this particular one that I'm indicating here by my mouse pointer, I have actually, well, I guess I've forgotten it, to indicate it, the attached nodes here of such an hyper edge are ordered. So you have in this case, a first and a second. And if you have three or four, then you have a first, second, third, and so on. So what do these rules mean? Well, they mean that if you find a hyper edge here that has a label S, so our hyper edges are labeled in order to have meaningful rules, you have a hyper edge with one attached node here that is labeled S, then you can replace this hyper edge by this right-hand side here. And in the right-hand side, you indicate by this little one here, which node in the right-hand side is the one that that was previously attached to this now replaced hyper edge here. So you would just remove the hyper edge here and add this structure instead to the node that the hyper edge here was attached to previously. So you add two outgoing edges to this hyper edge, to this node here. Oops, that was not. And then another hyper edge here, which is labeled A, connected to these two new nodes. Or you just terminate the whole thing and remove the hyper edge. The other one here, the other two rules are, once you have such a hyper edge labeled A here, you have two of these nodes here that it is attached to. Applying this rule means you remove this hyper edge, and what you add instead is that you take the first node here that this hyper edge was attached to. You add an outgoing edge. So of course, just an example, you could add anything else. Add an outgoing edge to a new node that you generate, and here also a new edge to a new node that you generate. You continue here by a new hyper edge labeled A, which is connected to these two nodes. The alternative rule here, this vertical bar, as usual, separates alternative right-hand sides for the same left-hand side. So you can continue adding hyper edges of this S type these two nodes here. If you use these rules over and over again, you will see that your S here is hanging on this node here. You produce two outgoing edges, so a binary thing here, and then you can for a while continue to produce two chains of edges which are of the same length then. And once you decide non-deterministically that that you have produced enough of them, you separate these two things and can again produce such a binary branching, or you can of course terminate the whole thing. So that shows that these hyper edges in this case just an edge because it has two or terminal non-terminal edge because it has two attached nodes can be used in order to basically coordinate or keep several nodes under control and make sure here, for example, that these two chains of edges generated here in this way are of the same length. So this is just a simple example. You could of course have larger hyper edges of connecting more nodes than just two, and in that case produce structures that where you have different nodes in the graph, and the structures that you produce somehow are, if you want, synchronized over these different places that you keep under control. These nodes here that are especially marked in this by these numbers 1 and 2, which correspond, I should have pointed to these two here in the right hand side, which are marked here in order to indicate that this is the node corresponding to the first attached node here in the left hand side, and this is the node corresponding to the second attached node in the right hand side. These nodes are usually called ports. So we consider as right hand sides and also as generated graphs that have a sequence of especially designated nodes which are called ports and which are used in order to make sure that things are attached to the right nodes, to those nodes that this replaced hyper edge has controlled, if you like. Because otherwise we wouldn't know, of course, whether this is the node or this is the node and so on. So if I in the following talk about ports, then it's those special nodes in the right hand sides or in generated graphs. So now I want to quickly explain to you that for some people it may be obvious, for others not. We can actually view the right hand side of such a rule, assuming for example that it has k non-terminal hyper edges in this right hand side, like this rule we've had before has one non-terminal hyper edge here in the right hand side. This rule that we had, or this right-hand side that we had, has two non-terminal hyper edges in the right-hand side. We can view those as operations on hypergraphs. And I have, as you see, I have left out the labels of these non-terminals here, of these non-terminal hyper edges, simply because if we view these graphs here or right hand sides of fluids as operations, it doesn't really matter which label they carry. So what is this? Well, I mean, we have this graph here and we want to view it as an operation, and the operation is just it takes a graph here as input, as argument, and this graph should have two ports corresponding to these two nodes here. So the graph should look something like this here, any arbitrary structure here, but it has two ports. And then applying this operation to this graph. Oh, what's this? Applying this operation to this graph here has the same effect as basically, yeah, replacing, or the effect is that this hyperedge here is replaced by the argument graph. So applying this operation to the graph G here just puts these two nodes on top of it with these two edges here. And this is the result of the operation. Note here that previously these two were the ports of the argument graph, and the resulting graph has the ports that are given by this, if you want, a specification of the operation or this right hand side here of the rule that we had on the previous slide. Same thing with this one here, but here we have two hyperedges in this graph, and so the operation has arity two. It would require two graphs as input or as argument, but these two graphs have only one port each. So what happens is we get one argument G1, another argument G2. Both have just one port here. So note that this here is a pair of graphs. It's not one graph, it's a pair of graphs, and each of them has one port. And what the operation does here is just it takes the if you want, disjoint union of these two, makes the first port of the first argument the first port of the result, and the second port of the result becomes what previously was the first port of the second argument. So in other words, we take this hyperedge, replace it by the first argument, and we take this hyperedge, replace it by the second argument, and the result is this. So if you do it like this, you can actually have an alternative formulation of how hyperedge replacement grammars generate their graphs. If we have the example that I had before, let's say this operation that corresponds to this graph here, we call it branch, and it has it takes one argument here, corresponding to this hyperedge. We have another one which we call singleton. It's just a an operation of arity zero. It just spits out or corresponds to the constant here. That's the graph of containing one node, which at the same time is a port. We have this operation, which we can call grow or whatever you'd like, also with one argument. And we have this one, which I, for the purpose of this presentation here, called union. You can call it whatever you like. And then we say, okay, now that we have these operations here, we can actually use a regular tree grammar in order to intuitively generate the derivation trees that the previous grammar would produce or would be characterized by. So we would say, okay, now we have a non-terminal here S, which is just a symbol, and we can replace it in our, so that's the starting symbol of the regular tree grammar. And we could replace it by this tree or term on the right-hand side, branch of A, or singleton, and A can be replaced by grow of A, this thing here, or union of S and S. So you see why the non-terminals are not any more of interest here when you define the operations. They have been moved into this regular tree grammar here. The regular tree grammar produces just trees or terms, if you want, expressions over these symbols here. And then you can simply evaluate those expressions by using the definition of these operations, and every such expression or term will evaluate to a graph. And if you like the context freeness, the property of hyperedge replacement graph grammars that corresponds to the intuitive context freeness, this is actually responsible for the fact that if we do it in this way, we generate those trees that this regular tree grammar produces and evaluate all of them, then we get exactly the same language as if you would use if you want graph centered view by having graphs all the time with hyperedges sitting inside of them, and then you replace. So if you want, it's a top down and a bottom up process which really this the evaluation of these expressions is a bottom up process which yields the same result as if you would follow the top down process of the graph grammar from the start. So in the following, I will use this way of looking at the graph grammars, and I will tell you why in a few minutes, I don't know, at some point. It is not so difficult to see, or maybe it's obvious to you even, that we actually need only three types of operations. We need graph constants, so that means operations of arity zero, which actually this is too general. If you want to be a minimalist, the empty graph would be sufficient, because you can always add something to the empty graph. But here I want to consider arbitrary graphs as constants, operations of arity zero, just like this singleton here. We could have any graph here which contains none of these, if you want, non-terminal hyperedges or hyperedges that indicate here I want to have an argument. Binary operations which do not add anything to the two input graphs, but just take a union of these two, and the result basically like this operation here, which takes a disjoint union of two graphs. We might also wish to consider other types of union which are not disjoint by fusing, identifying these two, for example, these two ports of the input graph, but we would not add anything to the graph. And then unary operations, which just extend the input graph in the same manner as these two here do. So they have only one argument graph and would add some stuff to this argument graph, like these two edges and these two new nodes, or this single branching node here. It's not too difficult to see that this really does it, because if you have operations of a greater arity, then you can split them up into binary operations, somewhat similar to the Chomsky normal form, but in a simpler way even. And then you can, if you want to put together these graphs, you can first take a union and then add stuff. So this is we actually need only consider these three types of operations. Hyperedge replacement, as is well known and easy to see, implies that the graphs that are generated have bounded tree width. And I don't know whether everyone's familiar with it, but it is based on the observation, the very trivial observation, that by the definition of these HR operations, these hyperedge replacement operations, they can only attach edges to the ports of the argument graphs, but not to the, if you want, internal nodes, so the non-ports of the argument graph. So, for example, if you have an argument graph here, you may one of these operations that adds stuff to the graph may add 1, 2, 3 new nodes where the middle one becomes the port, for example, and there are edges from this one to this one and from this one to this one, and two edges, one to the first port of the input graph and one to the second port of the input graph. But what we can't have is an edge like this that points from this node into the argument graph to some node within the argument graph, simply because the definition of these operations is that you connect the new things to the ports. That was the whole idea of the ports. So we can't establish edges like this, and that means in a way, this already shows you that the graphs are of bounded tree width, because this k here, the number of nodes that are ports in the argument graph, it essentially is the tree width of the graphs being generated. That's not really true, because you can have in these operations you can add arbitrarily complex structures to it of arbitrarily high tree width, but you have only finitely many in every grammar, so that doesn't really help you if you want to mess with the tree width and have a big tree width. It still is bounded, so you can, of course, split this graph here, this part, the upper part, from the argument graph by cutting through these nodes here, and so this cut of size k here will separate this blue part here, the argument graph, from the black part here. So why is that a problem? It's not really a problem if you want to produce things of bounded tree width, and we all know that bounded tree width is something that makes certain algorithms more efficient and so on and so on. So you should really want that if it suffices for the for your application domain. But one of the domains in which it actually can be seen as a problem is when you want to generate graphs that correspond to semantic structures in natural language processing, something like abstract meaning representation or so. For example, if you have a sentence like this, so you have some lengthy phrase that we don't need to care about what it actually is. So you have a long phrase, and you in your generation process, you want to consider this, or the graph that corresponds to this part here, you want to consider this to be the input of the operation that you are about to create, and you want the operation to add this part. What it should do is so you have this input graph here, and this input graph may contain lots and lots of nodes that correspond to individuals or in this lengthy phrase here, and there is this pronoun him, and you would like to somehow faithfully represent the semantics of this sentence. So what should you do? Well, you have to add things that correspond to and Jill likes him. Him should of course refer to something in this argument graph. And you can say, okay, and here this conjunction and here has one operand which is the port of this input graph here or this argument graph. That that is quite reasonable. So you have an and you have an edge from the and to this node here. You have another thing that the and actually connects to this here, and that has as its root the verb likes. One argument, the one who likes, the subject of this likes is Jill. That's also quite okay. So that's the argument zero. But then who is him? You want to do some kind of coreference resolution or whatever, and him should refer to John, to Joe, to Bob, maybe even to Maggie, depending on which pronouns she uses or they use. So we would like to produce an edge that, for example, goes to Bob here and is the first argument or the arg one, the object of the likes, or maybe to Maggie, or maybe to Joe, or to John. But we can't do this because this these nodes are not ports of this graph. Now you may say, okay, but why not produce here as argument graphs in our grammar graphs that contain additional ports? Well, we could do that. We could, for example, make sure that Bob is a port, but that doesn't really help, or that is not really appropriate because of actually many reasons. One of them is that while we are generating, let's say we look at this in a from a bottom-up perspective, creating this graph here in a way remembering that there is a Bob here, which might become an argument of something like likes or whatever, would require to non-deterministically choose this Bob while we are making this generation, but why Bob? Why not Joe? And then, of course, if we choose Bob instead of Joe, then on top of what we are generating here, there might be something that would reply like to refer to Joe. That there might be another him or whatever. So we would actually have to remember both Bob and Joe. And John and Maggie. So that doesn't really solve the problem because we can keep control only of a finitely bounded number of those ports. Depending on the representation that we use, we may actually want to say that Jill likes. If the sentence would be, and Jill likes them, we might wish to draw edges to all of them or to a subset. So all of this is not possible. And that's why we thought about how can you somehow build this a type of grammar that allows you to do this. One thing is that if you think about it, these rules here, if you disregard this red stuff and the problem of coreference resolution and similar problems, then you would actually like the thing to be structured in a way that gives you complete control over where do these edges go. So sometimes because you want to have this control over what is actually the graph structure that you are producing. For example, let's say the simplifying a bit, the operand here of the and, first of all, if you want to implement this here, the operand of the and should be the lights and not anything else. But also you may wish to make sure that and the root of the subgraph that the, or the two subgraphs in this case that the and refers to are in all cases verbs. So that this is actually a statement, if you like. So how do we, why isn't that going forward here? Okay, so that is what led us to define those graph extension grammars. And in those, the idea is very simple. We have these extension operations, that's why we call them graph extension grammars. The third type, wait a moment, why does that? The third type of where is this? So we are looking at the third type of operations here that we are allowed to use. The constants are the same, and actually, as mentioned, we could just use the empty graph or can. And then we have these union things that glue two graphs together. But then we have the extension operations, those which extend the input graph by new structure. And that is the thing that we would need here. So this is one of these operations, and we would like to add the ability to create this red stuff here. So how are we doing this? When we specify the operation, we do it precisely as before, but some of the nodes in this operation, some of the new nodes that are added to the argument graph, let's say v1 up to vk. So these are some of the nodes in this, if you want, right hand side. We designate them to be context nodes. So we call them context nodes. Let's say we denote this for the purpose of this talk by indexing the operation phi by v1 up to vk. The purpose of these context nodes is that when applying this operation, these nodes, each and every one of these nodes, we can do two things with it. We can clone it any number of times, where cloning means we can just duplicate it any number of times, also zero times. When we do it, we duplicate also the incoming and outgoing edges. So these are clones of the node. And then when we really apply the rule, we can identify these nodes, these clones, with arbitrary nodes in the input graph. Let's, for example, look at a really completely arbitrary example here. The operation could be this one here. It would take an input graph here of or an argument graph with k ports. It would that's actually the operation I had before here. It would add a new port and two additional nodes with an edge here and an edge here and two edges going to the first and the second port of the input or the argument graph, sorry. But then we have another node here, which I marked red here. This is the V1, so this one would only have one of these context nodes. And when we apply the operation to an input graph here, we duplicate this node any number of times, in this example, three times here, and identify the three copies with three nodes in the argument graph. I have indicated here that this, of course, makes the whole thing non-deterministic. So because we can make any number of clones, and we can also identify those clones any number of or with any arbitrarily chosen nodes in the argument. So that means that the application of such an operation doesn't anymore return a unique result, but it returns or gives rise to a set of resulting graphs. Formally, we just work from now on with sets of graphs rather than single graphs. Of course, we need some control. I mean, I said here, clone any number of times and identify with arbitrary nodes in the input graph. That is, of course, very, very weak. You wouldn't have any control over which structures you actually produce. This is actually too permissive. We need to establish some kind of control mechanism that tells us this is okay and this is not okay. So the idea how we do this is that if we have such an extension operation with context nodes V1 up to VK, then we in addition to having this operation here, we say that another component of this operation is a component that is some phi, component phi here that has k variables, which I denote x1 up to xk here with capital X's, indicating that these X's correspond to sets. And then we say that the evaluation of this thing on particular subsets of the nodes of an argument graph. So I get an argument graph, and in this argument graph, I choose k sets of the nodes, k subsets of the nodes of the argument graph. And I must have some way of evaluating this phi on these sets, and it should return either true or false. And if it returns true, then it is okay to produce clones of the V1 here. Each one of these clones corresponding to one of the elements of V1 here, and so on and so on. So that means that these node sets are actually permissible targets for the clones. So if you go back here, this would only be allowed if the capital V1 consisting of these three nodes here would satisfy this restriction here that is expressed by the small phi subscript capital phi. How can we specify those? Well, I already use notation here, which indicates that this might be a logical formula, and this is actually what we have considered in the paper that I mentioned at the beginning. We use monadic second order logic on graphs. If you are not familiar with it, that's a logic where variables can refer to singleton nodes, but also to sets of nodes, so that's the second order or the monadic second order aspects of it. We have variables that like X1 here that correspond to sets of nodes, and then this logic has the predicates that you would expect. For example, it can say that there is an edge from node so and so to node so and so, and it can say that the label of an edge is this and that, and it can say the label of a node is this and that, and it can say that this node is the first port or the second port or and so on. And then we build logical expressions with this vocabulary. And in order to find out whether V1 up to VK is okay, we would just evaluate the formula, and it would produce an answer telling us whether this is actually okay or not. So let's look at some very simple example here. We want to generate all binary trees over A and B. So A and B are labels of the nodes here, so that every A labeled node has shortcuts, so edges, to all of its A labeled descendants. So we can do this by saying that, okay, we have only one non-terminal, and the non-terminal can either generate an A-labeled node or a B-labeled node. It can also take this disjoint union of these two graphs generated by the S, and then put a B-labeled node on top of it. So this is this operation here. I have made a mistake here. This should of course be, or did I make, no, I didn't. So of course, this union thing here creates a graph like we had before. It takes two graphs and basically concatenates their external sequences of external nodes. So we have two external nodes then, and this operation here, which is only this one and doesn't include this, this operation here would just put a B labeled node on top of it with two edges, one going to the first external node of this argument here, and one going to the second external node of this argument. So this is just what would create ordinary binary trees all labeled with A's, with B's here. But then there's this operation here, which is similar, this rule here, which uses a similar strategy, this operation here is different in that it has this context node here, an edge to this context node, which is V here. So the subscript here indicates that this is a context node. And then we have to say, how do we, with which nodes are in the argument graph here, are we allowed to, or should we identify copies of this node here? And so these copies would, the target nodes of these copies here would correspond to whatever we have in this set variable X. And we would say, since we want to have these shortcuts to all the A labeled descendants, we would say for all X, if or X is in this set, so for all nodes X, the lowercase letters by convention are standing for nodes, individual nodes. So we would say for all nodes X in the argument graph, X belongs to this set X, so is one of the targets of these clones of V, if and only if the label of this node X is an A. So the if and only if makes sure that all of the A labeled descendants get such a shortcut edge, if you want. Of course, if we would only have an implication here, then it would mean that only A labeled nodes can have such a shortcut. If the implication would go into the other direction, then also B labeled edges can have a shortcut, but all A labeled nodes would have a shortcut. So this is of course a very simple example, but in this way we could, for example, say or express here in this previous example that all the targets of these red edges here should be nodes that that correspond to people or so. And of course, we could also make more complicated, create more complicated requirements there. So that is this. You may say monadic sector order logic is nice. It has many nice properties. It is very well studied in the context of graph languages and so on. We have nice results like Courcelles theorem, which is actually what we use in the paper that I mentioned initially. But if we want to, for example, generate semantic graphs in NLP and for other areas, you can certainly make similar arguments, then in some cases MSO logic may not be the ideal mechanism to express those conditions. And here are a few reasons. One is that it only yields yes and no answers. Formula specifies this is okay, but this is not okay. So it's really strict okay, not okay. If you look at for example, in NLP, reference resolution, then it's not always that strict. It might be that him, for example, is unlikely to refer to Maggie, but it could be so. So this yes-no restriction to yes-no or true-false is maybe not always ideal. It cannot, with a careful question mark here, be learned from data. would be nice to be able to do this, especially if you look at NLP and coreference resolution or whatever. And it does not efficiently construct suitable target sets. In the definition that I just showed you, you in a way propose these target sets V1 up to VK, and the formula tells you, yeah, that's okay. But if you want maybe translate sentences into graphs also and use this formalism in some way, then you would perhaps start with subgraphs that you would represent in this way, and then you would cover larger and larger subgraphs or larger and larger pieces of the string of the sentence, but then you would have to construct those target sets, and it's not really very clear how you would do it, at least not to me. And on graphs of unbounded tree widths, even the pure evaluation, so given these nodes or node sets, and asking yourself, is this phi sub phi, does it allow us this, becomes inefficient. So this the Cosell theorem only applies to graphs of bounded tree width. So one might wish to do something else, and that was actually something that I had in mind from the very beginning when starting to think about this. In the future, I would like to study whether and how we can use neural networks in order to realize this this phi, because I mean. Intentionally, it has been defined in such a way that this is actually an independent module, if you like. So we don't need to do it with MSO logic. It can actually be anything that either tells you yes, no, or and this is of course the one of the advantages of neural networks. It can always also be something in between, telling you, yeah, maybe, perhaps, but not so likely. And in this way, we may, get more interesting results. And of course, could in principle be learned, and the unbounded tree width maybe doesn't matter so much. So I would like to ask myself the question, or I do already ask myself the question, but I don't have any answers yet. Would it be an interesting thing to replace this MSO component by a neural network of some description? And could it be learned? And with that, I would like to conclude. If you think this is something that sounds interesting, just let me know. I mean, I'm very eager to work with others on this. And even if you want to work on it on your own, please be my guest. But it would be fun to work with someone else on this. That's what I had to say. Thank you for listening. Nobody interrupted me, maybe because nobody dared or so. But if you like, if there are any questions, Brink already said that he feels almost that is required. No, but. If you have questions, please ask.
Great. Thank you so much. Yeah, so we'll have some questions now, if anybody has any.
Yeah, I sort of did interrupt you here, Frank, but then you also answered my question. I wanted to change your chill example and chill like stem, but then you also explained that and made that suggestion yourself. So I was wondering with this formalism, I know in the past you've worked with others, in terms of whether you just want to apply to NLP or whether you have other applications in mind. I know with some of your previous graph grammar work, you've also applied it to programming code. So, I mean, something like this, would it make sense if I'm sort of interested whether some variable is, or whether variables are aliases of each other, or is there some sort of application like that to programming languages and programs and not just NLP?
Mm-hmm. It's always difficult to say before you have actually tried it out, but I think yes. The examples that you mentioned, actually I should say this, that is something I forgot. If you look at this formalism, it was actually inspired by this older work that we have been doing, but in a kind of a strange way, because these context nodes as I have investigated and proposed with actually my colleagues Mark Minas and Bertolt Hoffmann, we turned it upside down here in a way, because those context nodes, when you apply a rule in the ordinary way of working on hypergraphs and replacing hyperedges and so on, there we have the context nodes. Let's imagine you have applied rules over and over again. You have a big graph and there's a hyperedge sitting there somewhere, and you replace it, and the right-hand side by which you replace it has a context node. Then this context node can refer to something else in the context. So you would basically do the same thing as I did, to pick a node and identify this node in the right-hand side, the context node, with this node. But if you look a little bit more closely, this is basically complementary to what we do, because if you look at the derivation tree, then we are sitting somewhere here. And the context node can refer to or can basically target any node in the surrounding, whereas we, with our operations, work in the evaluation, work bottom up. And so the one thing that this one can't refer to is its own descendants. On the contrary, in our graph extension mechanism, you, in a bottom-up way, evaluate those sub-expressions, if you want, and then you arrive here at the root of a subtree, and it gets its argument, the already evaluated thing, and then you can refer with your context nodes to something inside here, but not because it doesn't yet exist, if you want, to anything in the surrounding. And the reason why we came up with it is actually that it has turned out that this previous formalism is computationally very difficult, because you can't create deadlock situations. If you look at the complete derivation tree, and someone here refers to something here, and this one, or in a way anthropomorphizing it, wants to refer to something here and this one to here and so on. So you, if you want to do parsing or anything like this, you have to make sure that these deadlock situations don't occur and so on, which we don't have any problems with here, because by definition there can't be anything like this. So, but maybe this strays away a little bit from your question. I think yes, I would say it can do interesting things in the programming case, and maybe even the fact that what I just described is the case actually makes it more suitable, because in a way, depends on what kind of structures you consider, also programming constructs and so on. But usually, I mean, you cannot refer to I don't know. I mean, to things in the surrounding in any way. I mean, I don't know actually, but my feeling is that it could be used in a good way. So, feeling is not the good answer, perhaps. But since I haven't tried it out yet. I don't actually know, because we have been working on these things only with those other grammars.
Mm-hmm. I'll jump in with a question then now. As I recall, like once you get above basically like, you know, regular languages and you get to these higher order things, then you have to be very careful with like how you define your grammar, especially like in the weighted case, like especially in the probabilistic case, where if you define things kind of poorly, you get degenerate. You can like blow up and not have like an actual probability distribution. Is it in this case though? It seems like these rules that you allow or forbid certain operations is sort of like bolted on at the end, and then it wouldn't necessarily change whether or not, like, suppose I had some well-formed probabilistic version of this, then there's no way that like that the choice of rule there could cause it to be ill-formed, right? Is that correct? It can only it seems like since it's like built on top of the grammar, not like productions in the grammar, then it seems to have slightly less effect, right?
Yeah, that's true. And I mean, it's of course intentional, because these things, because we wanted to separate between the structural things that you can and you actually want to express with this well-formed grammar stuff, and these rather arbitrary, I mean, coreference resolution is really the example, because if you have a him or so in a sentence, it can cut across the entire structure, and somewhere there's a gym, and yeah, that's him. So there's not really any well-formed structure there that you could use. I mean, there is some structure, and that's why coreference resolution exists, but it's somehow orthogonal to the rest of the structure. I don't know which consequences it has when you are looking at probabilistic things. I mean, you could, the usual thing would, or maybe the straightforward thing would be to use a probabilistic regular tree grammar in order to produce the, if you want, derivation trees, and then you can evaluate them. And as long as, the regular tree grammar produces something with a probability distribution, and as long as you make sure that all the different all the different ways directing these context nodes to different choices of targets for them, as long as you make sure that this also adds up to one in each particular case, it should all be fine.
Right, so it seems like it could make it like a sub-probability distribution, but it can't make it go infinite if it didn't already. Like it doesn't. Yes.
Because the number of choices is finite that you have there, and there can be many, many choices, but it's finite in every particular case. It depends on the size of the of the argument graph, so on the size of the 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 subtree basically to which the on top of which the operation sits, and how many nodes have been generated by. But because this is finite, whatever you do will result in a finite distribution.
Cool. Thanks.
So thanks very much for a very interesting talk. I had a question about the constraints on the sets assignable to the context nodes. When you have more than one context node in a rule, which I don't know whether that comes up in any practical sense, then the sets of values that you can assign to them, you get a Cartesian product.
Yes.
And I was wondering if there are circumstances in which you might want to constrain, sort of coordinate the constraints on two different context nodes. Maybe one, you know, if this is a subject, then, you know, this thing has to be something edible or whatever.
Yes. I mean, we haven't really studied so far which particular of these, if you want, coordination requirements might be useful. But at least if you use monadic second order logic, then many of these things can be expressed in the formula. You can say for all nodes in X1, there is a node in X2 or whatever. This is something also like, for example, that these sets should be disjoint can, of course, be easily expressed in monadic second order logic. So we can say that, no node is in both X1 and X2. Or we can say that one set is a subset of the other, or many of these things can be expressed by monadic second order logic, also of course very much more complicated ones. That is one thing that one may have to think about. We basically said, okay, we forget about all of these requirements as requirements here on the well-formedness of rules. So the rules themselves, or the phis, no, the rules, not the phis, the rules themselves and their definition do not impose any such restrictions, because we really realize that all we want to express can be expressed in the formula. So that would actually be useless to have it as a restriction in the way in which we apply the rules. But that is, of course, a good question, whether this would also hold if we, for example, replace the MSO by a neural component. Then, of course, the question is, what can we do there? Is it maybe even necessary, I don't know, to combine a formula with a neural network? But that, of course, becomes very awkward then, and I don't know whether I would like to to study this. But one could, of course, then, if one realizes that a neural component cannot express something very very basic and very important, then one could have a separate requirement saying that these sets must always be disjoint or whatever.
And I guess I had a question about the him versus them reference.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know enough about how such a thing would be represented semantically. Is it the case that them would refer to a collection of individuals sort of individually, or that there would be another value which was a set of individuals that it was referring to?
Good question. I think it's the first in many of these representations, but I wouldn't actually, I'm not so sure. From my point of view, for example, if you look at, how these representations like AMR or so are defined. I mean, it could be either one, and it doesn't really matter. It's just what people who define the representation thought would be most appropriate. And from a theoretical point of view, having this formalism, I think actually in this paper that I that is currently under review, we first had a version where we had an example which actually would use, I don't know, grouping nodes where the object would be one node, and then it would from there branch out to all the members of this group. That can always be done, or always, most of the time, I would guess, from the point of view of expressive completeness or so. I think it is very useful to be able to skip these grouping nodes and to have this kind of well, how many outgoing edges you want to have, you name it, because it seems to be, even if in some representations this might be the way in which people do it, it would seem to me that it's not the formalism itself should allow you to get away without these grouping nodes.
Mm-hmm. Again, thanks very much for the talk.
Thanks for listening.
Okay, if there are no more questions, then thank you again. It's a fantastic talk. And we will end the recording here.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure. Mm-hmm.